Thank you for the invitation. As Paul, I spoiled it a bit, I will be talking about composition of machines. So I will be talking about reversible transducers. I will try to give you intuition on how everything works, but try to be informal. So this is a joint work with Paulin Fournier, Ismaël Jacquer, who is at the back of the room, and Nathan Lott. So I will be talking about transducers, and Gabriele made a very nice introduction on everything, but I will redefine it, mainly because I didn't know that Gabriele would be talking about this, but then it would be nice to just give my settings, so because some things are different. So the first thing is a transducer. So you know all about automata and know about transducers. So you have an automata, and every transition is equipped with production, and the run of an automata is the same as of a transducer is the same as the run of an automata. So you will read your input here, which is the left part of the transition, and then you produce the output part, and then along the run you concatenate the production and it gives you an output word. So here you start in state one, you read a B, you produce a B, and then you read an A and you produce A, B, A, etc. And then you get, from an input word, you get an output word. So instead of automata, that gives you a yes or no answer, then you have input and output. So you realize the function from words to words. And the natural question when you're dealing with function is, can you compose it? But the idea is, of course, these are functions, so you can compose it. But the idea is, if I'm given two transducers, can I construct another one that does this composition? Meaning that I'm a machine stable by composition. So here we're dealing with one-way transducer. So here is the setting. You have one transducer A that reads some letters A's and produce some letters B's. And then you have a B transducer that read B's and produce C's. So you want to do the composition. And, well, the first easy way to do it is then you first run your transducer on the input for A, and then you produce the output. So here you read the A1, you produce B1, B2, and then you produce B3, etc. So you have a working tape here that stores the output of A. And then you use this working tape to work to simulate your B transducer, and then you get the second part. Okay, so in the end, you realize the composition. But if you want to do it with only one machine, you cannot do this. Because here, your working tape is of unbounded size, so you can do it with a finite state machine. So the solution that has been known for, as far as I know, as long as transducers, is to do it on the fly and to use a buffer. So instead of storing the whole working tape, you will have a buffer that will store part of your calculus, of your execution. And then, upon reading an A, instead of producing this B1, B2, you will store it in a buffer. So you will go here to a state with a buffer. So you will read A1 and produce epsilon, and then go to the buffer that will... And then you will have states that consume the buffer. So you will read the B1 and produce C1, C2, and then read B2 and produce C3. So this is easy, and the buffer is bounded by the size of a production, so everything is finite, it works well, and you can get rid of the epsilon transition because there is a finite number of them. So you can do something like this, and then you have one machine that does the composition, and its set of state is just one state from the transducer A and one state from the transducer B. Everything good so far? You can do the composition. Here I say one way because I will be talking about more expressive models. And you can do with a single transducer the composition, and it has a polynomial number of states, meaning linear in both of the machines. And it's a very strong and very robust construction. I mean, it preserves determinacy, it preserves functionality. Everything works really well. It's rather simple. And the question that we ask is, yeah, what about two-way transducers? So as Gabriele said, it can be done, but it's harder. But what if we want to compute two-way transducers? Then, oh yeah, first I will define what I mean by two-way transducer, because it's slightly different from Gabriele's. Is that you have, similarly, your transducer that reads letter and produce outputs. Here you have some specific letters because it will be the end markers of your input words. And because you will allow your reading head to move to the left and to the right, then you need to be able to stay within the bounds of your words. So these are necessary evil. And how do you decide if you're moving your reading head to the left or to the right? Here it will be written in the states. Meaning that if I'm a blue state, then I'll be moving to the right, and if I'm in an orange state, I'll be moving to the left. Okay, so it's a bit more precise than that. It's if I'm going to a blue state, that I will be moving to the left. If I'm going to an orange state, I'll be moving to the right. So I will explain here. So it works similarly. I start in an initial state by reading the beginning marker. So I will first take in the state one that read the input and produces the same letter, read A's and B's and produce same letter. So I will here have my output tape that produces. And then when I reach the end marker, I go to an orange state, and then I know that I will have to move my reading head to the left. So upon taking this transition from one to two, I will move to the other side, and then I will stay in orange state, reading also my input. And then going to a blue state, then I know that I have to switch direction again, and so I will go, and then I accept when I'm a final state here, at the end of the word. So the important thing is, my reading head can move both ways, but my output tape, that is just a writing tape, only moves one way. Okay, from Y to left, I cannot go back and read it again. I just produce and concatenate. So this is my model of two-way transducer, and what happens if we want to compose them? Oh yeah, why do we care about this? Because they are much more expressive than a one-way transducer. Because in the case of automata, it's equally expressive, but then it's also a very robust class that I will not be talking about. But it's there have been many interest in this class recently. So if you want to compose them, then the natural thing is to try to do the same thing as before. When you are in blue states, then you're like in a one-way case. So you're just doing the computation, and you want to use this buffer to store the production, and then producing the output of the buffer. But some problem arise when the second transducer, B, is going to an orange state. Because then you want to move backward. Instead of moving forward, you want to go backward. So you don't want to read this B3, this is a mistake. You want to read this B1, B2, the previous buffer, but you forgot about it. You consumed it, you forgot about it. So now you have to recalculate it. So you need to go back in the run of A and recalculate it. But then you can have a problem, because how do you know if you came from this transition P1 and you produced B1 and B2, or if you went to this other transition P1 prime that produced B1 prime? So here it's easy because it's one step, but you can go unbounded number of times backwards, so you have problems. And so you cannot decide where to go. Well, you cannot decide directly where to go. But as Gabriele said, composition is still doable. It's a result that is by Kittel and Jäkel from 77, and they are using a very nice trick by Hopcroft and Ullmann. And basically, the composition of two two-way transducers can be done also with a two-way transducer. But the problem is the complexity is roughly 3x. Maybe you can do, if you're a bit smarter, you can do it better, but you have 3x in the size of A, mainly. And that is the starting point of our work, is that can we do better? Can we have a better complexity? Because in the one-way case, it's polynomial. It's very easy to understand. This construction is very involved and with high complexity, so can we do better? Or if we can't do better, maybe we can find a subclass that does it better. So how do we get a subclass with better composition? Well, for this, you need to understand why it is easy in the one-way case and why it becomes involved in the two-way case. So in the one-way case, it's easy because basically execution only moves forward. So when you do a choice, even if it's non-deterministic, you never have to do it again. So you can solve everything locally. You can decide what you do locally and do everything locally, and it works well. But in the second way, mainly because of this, you cannot solve everything locally. You have to think globally, because every time you go to a position, you need to take the same transition. So you need to think about the run in its entirety. And it's not because of non-determinism, because given a run, you have to go back to exactly to the same place. And even if you're non-deterministic, then it has a problem that doesn't happen in your one-way case. So these are the problematic patterns. And so the natural idea is to forbid them. So here comes a reversible machine. And the idea is that a machine that is reversible if you can execute it and rewind it in a deterministic fashion. Meaning, if I'm given any input anywhere in the run, I can go to the next step or the previous step really easily in a deterministic fashion. And that's what it means in our case. So we will require to be input deterministic, meaning that you don't have two transitions going from the same state, and input codeterministic. And this is exactly my problematic patterns that I forbid now. And so reversible transducer will be this. And the good news is, when you're reversible, composition works well. You can do it with a machine that has a polynomial number of states. And in fact, it's the same idea as a one-way case. You can do it with your buffer, and everything works really well. So that's a good thing. And it's also very strong, because if both machines are reversible, then you get also a reversible machine. And for scalability, if you want to compose several machines, then it will be very useful. And so we have our subclass. And we can ask about the expressiveness of our class. And, well, first a word about one way is that in the one way case, you're very less expressive. And why is it the case? It's because being deterministic means that your transition relation is a function. And being codeterministic means that this function is injective. So in fact, you get bijection. Every letter induces a bijection on the state. Here's the B letter induces the identity, and the A letter induces the switch. So the idea is that everything you do is somehow a group. It's inversible, hence the name. So this has been characterized by Jean Rictin. It's well known. Mainly, you do group languages. And so even in the transducer case, you are much as expressive. And so you cannot do very simple language like this set of words that contains an A. And why is it the case? Well, here you see an automata for this language, and you see that it's not codeterminist, because when reading an A from the final state, you don't know if you come from the first state or the second state. And the idea is, if you want to make it codeterministic, then this A, when reading an A from this state, you have to go to another state. But you cannot go to this state because it's not an accepting state, so you have to go to a third state. And then the same problem happens, and then you need an infinite number of states. Okay, so this language that is expressible in most logic, most formalism, is not reversible. So in the one-way case, you don't get much expressiveness. But that's not why we define them. We define them for two-way, and in fact, for two-way, you get you don't lose any expressiveness by considering reversible transducer. And in fact, we have a procedure that takes two-way transducer and constructs a reversible one. So here I will mainly talk about deterministic transducer. I will talk about non-deterministic in the conclusion. But we can construct one. So you don't lose any expressiveness. You have a procedure that is exponential. So in fact, you get the composition for free for an exponential price. And the idea is, yeah, you first transform the automata, the transducer A into a reversible one. And in fact, you separate the composition complexity. You separate the complexity from the machine because you first pay this exponential price, and then you can do it. It scales very well, no matter how you do it. If you have several machines, you would instead the 3x1, you have to be careful about not exploiting your set of states. So the remainder of my talk, I will try to convey intuition about why this works, and tell me if I'm not clear. The first step, important step, is do it for a one-way machine. So here I will take a one-way codeterministic transducer. It would work also for deterministic. And we will construct a two-way reversible one that has a polynomial number of states. And just to be easy, I assume that I have one initial state. This is to ensure that I have only one accepting run. It will be easier for me. And that I'm weakly branching, meaning that when I have non-determinism, then it's limited to only two choices. So it's a small non-determinism. So I will prove. I will give you the construction on an example. So here you have a transducer that has mainly three states and one initial and final state. And you can go to the state one or state two, and then from state two to state three. And it's also, you can check that is codeterministic because you can just check for every state that is codeterministic. And the idea is you can either go to one or two. You will go to two if you don't have any B except for the last letter. And you will go to state one if you have one B except the last letter. So, and how do you construct the reversible machine? Well, you take your input one and you will consider the branching tree of the execution. Meaning you take every run that is possible on this input one, and you will explore it to get to the final state. So this is a construction that was already known for automata, for going from a one-way automata to a two-way reversible one. And the idea is you will explore it until you get to a final state. But here we have something more involved, because we not only need to know if we reach a final state, we need to know how. We need to know each transition that is taken along the run, because we need to do the productions. So the idea is that we'll explore it, and we'll explore it in two ways. One is above the branching tree, and one token is below the branching tree. And we know that if they agree, if they're on the same state, then it's the transition that is taken. Okay? So you have to be careful to do it in a reversible way, and to have the two tokens that are simultaneate. But the idea is this. You have one token will be above everything that we don't know if it's the accepting run, and the other it will be below. So you have this run. So here from QI, you can either go to one or two, and you're still below. You don't know which run works. And then you go to state three here, and you realize that you cannot read a B from state three. So you have to go back here, and then from state two you see the other branching, so you go back to state two, and you realize this, that when this doesn't move, then this one also doesn't move, because they need to be synchronized. Okay. So here you go, you see that this one is done, so you go back, and then you go back, and you can be tempted to go directly this way, but if you go from this state to this one, then you've violate the reversible property. So in fact, you need to do the long way around and explore your whole branching tree. But you can do it here. And here you see that when you're going from state one to state two here, they will agree. So you know which transition was taken, and then you can produce accordingly. So afterwards, you have to do the computation again. So it explodes the length of the computation, but you're reversible, and then they agree, and you can produce. Here you produce, and then you have your output. Okay, so from a one-way here codeterministic, but also deterministic, it works. You can construct a reversing two-way transducer. And I did not show you this for nothing, because it will be a huge ingredient in our proof. Because, yeah, the main utility of composition is that you can also decompose. Because if you decompose something into smaller bits and you are able to compose them, then everything works well. So for my transducer A, I will decompose it into two transducers. One is a one-way codeterministic, and this is where you pay the exponential price, because this one-way will have an exponential number of one. And then the second one is a reversible two-way. So the first one, what it does is it will guess all the information needed in the run for the two-way, in a way. And the second one will just use this information to do the transformation, the function of A, in a reversible manner. And how does this work? Well, how does this one work? It's a classical slice transducer, something like Shefferson. So it's something that has been known for a long time. So you have this run of your automata. Here you have, so this is the same transducer as early, except that you will require your input to be A star, B star, just so it's not already reversible. And then what you do is that you will guess what happens in the remainder of the run. And that's why you're codeterministic, because you will guess that, yeah, what happens afterwards is exactly the image of ABB. So you have, when reading this this end marker, you will guess the zero and guess that you at some point reach an accepting state. And that is what you enrich your input with. And then you go on the next step, and then you guess that you're the first A here, so that you go back to state 2 from state 3. And you do this for every machine. And you can get the information of the slices. Okay? And you can do it in a codeterministic fashion, because you guess exactly what happens in the remainder of the run. So this is for the first one. And the second one, well, it simply uses all this information to solve the transaction with in a reversible way. And how does it do it? It just has the set of states of your automaton. And then if you have all this information, then think, it should be a one here. If you guess that if you are in a state one, then you can only use the slice to know that you will use this information. And if you're in a state one here and you want to know what was previous, then you just read the letter, and then you know that what you do. Okay, so the slice information allows you to be completely deterministic and codeterministic. So two-way reversible, they are really good for composition. They scale very well. It's easily done. It's very similar to one-way machine, and they are as expressive as deterministic two-way transducer. And in fact, it's what we have is a bit more than that. Is that you also only pay an exponential price if you're going from functional to reversible. So you have the same this exponential blow up already exists when you're going to from functional to determinism, but going from functional to reversible is the same price. And in fact, we have something a bit stronger, is that if you're taking any two-way that is non-deterministic, then you can extract a functional one that is reversible with an exponential number of time. It's just ordering the run and picking one. And then we still have some question, because this exponential that is required from is it still needed when you're going from a deterministic one to reversible? This we don't know yet. It might be true, and we can ask if you can extend this to other model. For example, firmly believe that if you're considering a visibly pushed down transducer, for the one who know about it, this technique will still work. And maybe some higher expressive model, for example, like Pebble Automaton or something. And that's it for me. Yeah. Thanks.